Hello, welcome to the lecture number 4 of the course Quantum Mechanics and Molecular Spectroscopy. Before we get on with the lecture number 4, we will have a quick recap of lecture number 3. In lecture number 3, we looked at two important points. First is that an average value of A operator is given by psi A psi, this is nothing but integral psi star A operator. Okay. This is also equal to psi A psi, this is equal to integral psi star A psi d tau, where psi equals to small psi into e to the power of minus I e t by h power. And of course, this is only valid if, you know, psi is a stationary state. Secondly, we said that the time dependence of the average value of operator A is equal to I h bar average value of the commutator h comma a. Okay. It simply means that the average value of A or the expectation value of an operator A will have time dependence or not, will depend on whether it will commute with the Hamiltonian or not. If it commutes with Hamiltonian, then there will be no time dependence, and if it does not commute with Hamilton, it will show some time dependence. And I also told you that this is very useful in spectroscopy because the operator A corresponding to the interaction of light with the matter or white with the molecule or atom, okay, does not commute with the Hamiltonian of the molecule or the atom. Therefore, one can make a transition from a one expectation value, say 1s orbital or 1s energy level in hydrogen atom, to some other energy level, say 2s or 2p. There is another interesting thing, that is, if you have two operators f and g, the uncertainty relation of the expectation value of operators f and g is equal to, is always going to be greater than half of f and g commutators. Okay. For example, we know that Heisenberg's uncertainty principle says delta x delta px should be greater than equal to half h bar, which means the operator x and operator px, okay, do not commute. In fact, this is not equal to 0. Okay. Now we know the time dependence of an average value of A will just depend on the, that operator will commute with Hamiltonian or not. Okay. We will now go to the second part of our course, that is the time dependent perturbation theory. To begin with, I will show only time dependent perturbation theory of two states, because it has some interesting consequences. So, we will start with time dependent perturbation theory of two states. Okay. Now, what does this mean? It means the following. For example, if you had an Hamiltonian H naught, that means some Hamiltonian for which you know the solution, and that acts on a wave function psi 1, that will give you E1 psi 1, and this H naught acts on psi 2 will give you E2 psi 2, and H naught has only two solutions. That is, so therefore, the psi 1 and psi 2 form a complete set. And what did I say about complete set? Any arbitrary function phi can now be written as a linear combination of A1 psi 1 plus A2. Okay. This is like a plane. Okay. If you have a plane, you only need two coordinates, x and y. So, any point in the plane is a linear combination of x and y. So, we have a kind of a restricted environment where the Hamiltonian will be restricted to a plane that is consisting of psi 1 and psi 2. Okay. Now, I am going to slightly rewrite this. Okay. So, you have H naught in terms of bracket notation 1 is equal to E1 1 and H naught 2 is equal to E2 2, where psi 1 is identically equal to 1 and psi 2 is identically equal to 2. Okay. So, if psi 1 and psi 2 form a complete set, then there is another complete set that is nothing but 1, 2. I also told you that there is also another complex set that is made up of complex conjugates of 1 and 2. So, that is nothing but set 1, 2. So, these two are complex conjugates of each other. So, now we have this problem in which H naught of 1 is equal to E1 1 and H naught of is equal to E2 of 2. Okay. Now, let there be a some kind of perturbation. Okay. So, what will this perturbation do? It will move the states. So let me write the Hamiltonian corresponding to the, when you have a perturbation, the total Hamiltonian H will be nothing but H naught plus some perturbation H prime of T, because we are looking at time dependent perturbation. Okay. Now let us suppose, okay, if there is a point or a ball kept on the surface of the surface of a floor, and then one can think of playing a football. So constantly someone is kicking it, okay, because then the ball will keep moving all over the floor. Or if you go to a football match, okay, then there is this floor or the ground in which there is a football is kept, and the ball and the players are kicking the ball in different directions, and that is your time dependent perturbation. So what will it happen? It will keep moving its position, but let us assume that it is always restricted to the ground, okay. So but its position is going to change. So every time you have a new position, it can be written as a linear combination of some new x and y. So it has to be a linear combination of nu, 1 and 2. And this position is going to be time dependent. Therefore, the wave function psi can be now written as a1 of t into 1 e to the power of minus I e1 t by h bar plus a2 of t 2 e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar. So that is my wave function. That wave function works with this entire Hamiltonian. Of course, if h prime t goes to 0, then a1 and a2 will collapse to some value. In fact, will go, either a1 will go to 0 or a2 will go to 0. Okay. So now we will go back to our Schrodinger equation, which is nothing but I h bar d by dt of psi equals to h psi. So finally, what we want to do is we want to solve this Schrodinger equation with this wave function. Okay, so let us do it. So this will be I h bar d by dt of a1 of t e to the power of minus I e1 t by h bar 1 plus a2 of t e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2. Okay. This should be equal to h into a1 t e to the power of minus I e1 t by h bar 1 plus a2 of t e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2. Okay. Now this is a long equation. So what I am going to do is I am going to call this as LHS, that is left hand side, and I am going to call this as RHS. I will evaluate the left hand side and right hand side independently and then equate them later. So let us start with LHS. LHS equals to I h bar d by dt of a1 of t e to the power of minus I e, e1 t by h bar 1 plus a2 of t e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2. Okay. Now let's take the derivative. Now we'll see that in each of these terms, okay, term 1 and term 2, there are two time dependent parts, a1t and e to the power of minus I e1t h bar. Similarly, a2t e to the power of minus e2t by h bar. So you have to use a product rule of differentiation. What you get is I h bar a1t dot, okay, where a1t dot is equal to d a1t by dt. Similarly, a2 dot of t is equal to d a2 t by dt. It's just a notation, okay, just keep in mind. When I say put a dot over some thing, it means it's a time derivative, okay. E to the power of minus I e1t by h bar 1 plus a1t. Now I will take the time derivative of the other one. This will be minus I e1 by h bar e to the power of minus I e1t by h bar 1. Similarly, you get a2 dot t e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2 plus a2 t minus I e2 t by h bar into e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2. So, this I can rewrite as is equal to I h bar a1 dot t e to the power of minus I e1 t by h bar 1 plus a2 dot t e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2. Okay. Now you can see there is an I here and there is an I here. I square, that will be minus 1, and there is a minus sign as well, so that will become plus 1. There is a h bar in the numerator and there is an h bar in the denominator, so these two get cancelled. So essentially what to get is that plus e1 into a1t e to the power of minus I e1t by h bar 1 plus e2 to a2t e to the power of minus I 2t by h bar 2. So there are four terms. I'll call this as L1, that is LHS1, L2, LHS2, L3, LHS3, L4, LHS4. Okay. Now let us look at the RHS. This is nothing but your H, okay, acting on your wave function, that is nothing but A1 of t e to the power of minus I E1 t by H bar 1 plus a2 t e to the power of minus I e2 t by h bar 2. Okay. I want to quickly go back and see that, you know, there are four terms. Okay. the first two terms are the time derivatives with respect to A1 and A2, and the second two terms have this energy values E1 and E2. So, something that you must remember. Okay. Now, this is equal to nothing. This is nothing but is equal to your H is nothing but H naught plus H prime T. Okay. Now, this must act on A1 of T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus A2 T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 2. Okay. So, this will be nothing but A1 of T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar. H naught will only act on 1. So, H naught acting on 1 plus A2 times T e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar H naught acting on 2. You see, because H naught is your initial Hamiltonian, which is nothing but your time independent Hamiltonian. So, it will not act on anything that is time dependent. Okay? So, either A1 T or e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar. It will only act on the state A1 and give you E1 1. Okay? Similarly, the second part of the equation. Okay? Plus A1 T H prime T now acting on e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar acting on 1 plus A2 times T H prime T acting on e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar 2. Okay? So, these are the four terms that you will get. Now, I will act. Now, when H naught acts on 1, it will give me E1 1. So, this will become E1 of T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus second one H naught acting on 2 will give you E2 T. So, A2 of T e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar 2 plus the two terms, that is A1 T H prime of T acting on e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus A2 of T H prime of T acting on e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar 2. So, here also we get four terms. This I will call it as right hand side 1 R1, right hand side term 2 R2, right hand side term R3, right hand side term 4 R4. So, but you know LHS and RHS must be equal. So, LHS must be equal to RHS. Now, you will quickly see that L3 term is equal to R1 term and L4 term is equal to R2 term. So, this one here and this one here R1 R2 will be equal to L3. L3 and L4. So, since L3 and L4 are equal to R1 plus R2, so which means you can cancel out each other. So, what you will be left out with is IH bar A1 dot T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus A2 dot T e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar 2 is equal to A1 T H prime T acting on e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus A2 T H prime T acting on e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar. So, this is what you get from the that equation. Okay. Now, let us do some little bit of math. Okay. Now, what I am going to do is the following. I am going to multiply with psi 1 star on the left and integrate. This simply means that I will put a function like that and multiply and integrate. Now, if I do that, I will get I h bar 1 A1 dot T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus 1 A2 dot T e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar 2. This is equal to 1 A1 T H prime T e to the power of minus I E1 T by H bar 1 plus 1 A2 T H prime T e to the power of minus I E2 T by H bar. I will have four integrals that I have to evaluate. If I can evaluate these four integrals, then I will know the time dependence of this perturbation. We will carry on the remaining part in the next lecture. I am going to stop now. Thank you.